We're all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
I think nature's imagination is so much greater than man's. He's never gonna let us relax.
We live in an in-between universe where things change all right, but according to patterns, rules, or as we call them, laws of nature.
I'm just a standing on a planet. Really, I'm just a speck. Compared with a star, the planet is just another speck. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space. There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks.
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. Cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away from the cosmos and know itself. Across the sea of space, the stars are alert. Sun. We've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
We're all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomic.
I find it elevating and exhilarating to discover that we live in a universe which permits the evolution of molecular machines as intricate and subtle as we.
I know that the molecules in my body are traceable. Phenomenon in the cosmos that makes me want to grab people in the street and say, have you heard this?
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away from the cosmos and know itself.
There's this tremendous mass of waves all over in space, which is the light bouncing around the room, going from one thing to the other. And it's all really there, really, really there. But you gotta stop and think about it, about the complexity, and really get the pleasure. It's all really there, really, really there. The inconceivable nature of nature. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space.
There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks. The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away from the cosmos and know itself. Across the sea of space, the stars are alert. Sun. We've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
That was the Talking Alternative Radio Encore broadcast. We hope you enjoyed it. Now, for the live shows, professionals serving community, talkingalternative.com.
Thank you. Hey, everybody, and welcome to a brand new episode of Frank About Health. Today, we are going to be frank about caregiving. My special guest today is Phyllis S. Quinlan, PhD, RN, and BC. I need you to explain to me BC in a moment, but for the purposes of our discussion today, we're going to definitely be talking to a highly qualified, skilled nursing professional and professional caregiver and consultant to a lot of the healthcare workers, especially in the New York area. I'm sure she's also going to talk about the works that she has written about and about a special organization that invites all of us to share the care. More of that later. And for the purpose of the show, we're going to refer to her as Dr. Phyllis, my version of Dr. Phil, but except as she once told me, she has hair. Welcome to this episode of Frank About Health. I'm really looking forward to our discussion.
It's an honor, Frank. I've been excited for this. It's really an honor.
Well, I remember when we first started talking, you'd mentioned that some particular shows of Frank About Health actually triggered, I guess, an automatic response in you to be part of the show. In what way? Can you exemplify that a bit or explain how?
Sure. The programs, I believe there was at least three that I was able to listen to that dealt with the caregivers and how they were able to navigate being under the influence of a narcissist. Those very much rang home to me because I do a lot of work with disruptive behavior, bullying, and incivility in the healthcare setting. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the thoughts I put forward is that a bully is actually a narcissist, and in some cases, a narcissist with a license or a narcissist in the healthcare profession.
Correct. So I gather as your career progressed as a nurse, did you experience all that bullying working with fellow nurses or doctors or the patients themselves?
You know, when I started nursing, quite honestly, I don't think we had a great deal of awareness about bullying and incivility. There was this, you know, understanding that nurses perpetually eat their young, which, you know, unfortunately still lives. But, you know, I've been practicing nursing for 43 years. So, you know, when I started practicing, we were still somewhat connected to the transactional heritage that we had, which was really founded in the military and in religious life, you know, and much of the hierarchy in nursing comes from the military, you know, the uniform and the hat, which is a shorter version of a veil, you know, will come from the, you know, the religious section. But there was a whole lot of do what you were told and don't ask too many questions and keep your head down. And, you know, as nursing progressed as a profession, there was higher expectations from people who practiced and that we were moving to more of a, you know, a workplace that had more participation from staff, that had more participation, what we called shared governance. Mm-hmm. And that we all had something to bring to the table and that the organization and the profession of nursing was becoming less top down and far more participatory.
So when you entered the nursing profession, did you go into it with that mindset already or you just literally lived as you lived and learned as you went along your training?
I lived and learned as I went along. I'm sure that as many people, you know, who have gone into a caring profession have, you know, discovered, you're a little shocked to find out that bullying and incivility is something that lives, you know, in that particular culture. And, you know, it wasn't really until I started professionally coaching about 20 years ago and started hearing some more stories that echoed my own or echoed other things that I started to realize that we had something within the profession, within that work place, that work venue, if you will, that really needed to be brought into the light of day, that really needed to be focused on more. And I think since we, except for those colleagues that are specializing in behavioral health, right, most of the clinicians that I know of and most of the nurses that I know of, you know, are a little reluctant to deal with behavior. That's not where our strength is. Our strength is in things to do with physiology and pathophysiology, you know, something you can put pressure on and elevate, something you can start an IV on or do CPR on. But, you know, unless you have truly, you know, specialized in behavioral health, you find yourself not well equipped, not, you know, to be able to deal effectively with the disruptive behavior that comes with the territory, the disruptive behavior that might come from the patient, the patient's family or visitors. But the one that really disturbs me the most is the disruptive behavior that comes from within, between colleagues.
Wow. So when did you first discover that, while you were in your version of residency, or did you discover it in medical school or nursing school?
I think I was about, well, the first time I was up against bullying probably was 3 weeks into the profession. I just didn't know what I was dealing with. I just thought I was dealing with a little, you know, a person that was somewhat cantankerous. And again, there was, you know, this rites of passage, you know, that, you know, this is what you have to put up with, or this is what you have to navigate in order to get to the other side of it. And, you know, this is part of the shaping of you as a professional in the beginning. And, you know, my experiences weren't that profound in the beginning. Once or twice, I certainly was on the receiving end of, you know, something that was definitely disruptive and disconcerting, and at some point frightening. But I think it was really when I was started to do coaching more full time, I started working with nurses in particular that were suffering from what we call compassion fatigue, otherwise known as burnout.
Right,
and
right.
When I started getting more and more calls from those professionals and working with those professionals about how to navigate returning back to the joy of what they do, the stories of bullying and incivility really started to bubble up. And then several years ago, I was offered the opportunity, about 10 years ago, I was offered the opportunity to be the professional coach, personal and career coach for AORN, which is the American Organization of Perioperative Nurses. And back in 2016, they asked me to do a 10-city tour talking to the nurse executives from all of the perioperative areas within like 10 catchment cities, Seattle, New York, Chicago. And when we started, and there was a full day dedicated to talking about the issue of disruptive behavior, and hearing their stories really drove it home more. And from that came a book that I wrote, really to, you know, start to talk about the issue and give them a little bit more of a guideline of how to navigate it more effectively.
So essentially, when you started in your nursing training, you were looking at particular categories of patients and particular illnesses, and then migrated into the behavioral spectrum, and therefore got your PhD to complement that, or was that all together?
Well, when I first started college, I was coming out of not the best experience in high school. I was undiagnosed as a dyslexic. Back in the days when I started, I graduated from high school, I was just a kid who knew that if I was going to go to high school, I was going to go to summer school. I was horrible in math, and subsequently, you know, some of the sciences like chemistry and physics, you know, suffered from that as well. And it wasn't until my first freshman year that I had a professor who saw the struggle that I had and got me to the resources that I needed, and realized that I had a learning challenge, which at the time was brand new. We were learning very little. This is 1971. We were just starting to learn about learning challenges and things of that nature.
Right.
Once I had that and I got through, I actually graduated college with a degree in psychology and a degree in sociology, and became a psychiatric social worker for a very brief period of time. I had the confidence to go back and get my nursing degree. So instead of going on to graduate school, I got a third baccalaureate degree in nursing. And when I came out of that, I thought I would become a psychiatric nurse, but oddly enough, I found myself in critical care emergency trauma. And that's where the majority of my clinical career has been spent, but there was always an opportunity for me to use my sociology and my psychology and you know, the psychiatric social work piece of that.
Right, right.
So, you know, it was almost like I oddly found the way I needed to prepare for what I'm doing now. It just didn't seem so obvious at the time.
No, but that brings me to the question, what does BC mean? Business consultant? Is that
what? No, it doesn't. It means that I'm board certified. I'm board certified in three areas. I'm board certified in critical care. I'm board certified in emergency nursing. And I'm also board certified in nursing professional development.
Wow. I mean, it's amazing to me because in all the episodes that I've done about, you know, regarding Frank About Health, they've always focused on the illness. And I've had one or two doctors come on who are published or they're professors now in their medical school, or I've even had some attorneys, but you are literally my first nurse.
Well, I'm honored, right?
Yes, no, and actually, we've already talked about this, but I am thinking of having you come on future episodes that I produce that are relevant to the work that you have done and have experience in to actually help in consulting the way a nurse would with a person who has faced a critical trauma or mental disorder, but definitely
behavioral challenge.
Behavioral challenge, exactly. And the thing is that I'm always on the show defending that I'm not a doctor and right. I'm not in license to prescribe any solution right. to their problems. I'm just spreading the word around, but to have someone who's board certified join me on the show, you're going to add a layer of credibility and a point of reference for people out there, both on talkradio.nyc and Facebook,
right.
that are able to really come to Frank About Health as a place to really get some advocation, some support right. for whatever is ailing them.
That's a big responsibility, Frank, but I stand ready to accept it. 2020 was heralded as the year of the nurse. And then of course the pandemic came and, we expected the year to celebrate nursing in a very, very different way. So actually 2021 was kind of held over as the year of the nurse as well. So for nursing to finally find its way to Frank About Health in 2021, if I can be part of raising awareness about what this wonderful profession offers patients and the healthcare profession, I'm honored to do it.
Well, we're about to take a break and time flies when I'm having fun, and I'm certainly having fun with you right now, but we're going to talk about some of the work you've done. I know you have a book out there on Amazon.com that we want to discuss, and also want to find out about some of the shows that you had your own nursing-wide opinions about from Frank About Health, and also discuss some of the other organizations you're working from. So ladies and gentlemen, please stay tuned for this episode of Frank About Health. We are being frank about caregiving with Dr. Phyllis. Stay tuned.
Are you a business owner? Do you want to be a business owner? Do you work with business owners? Hi, I'm Stephen Fry, your small and medium-sized business or SMB guy. And I'm the host of the new show, Always Friday. While I love to have fun on my show, we take those Friday feelings of freedom and clarity to discuss popular topics on the minds of SMBs today. Please join me and my various special guests on Friday at 11 a.m. on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a conscious co-creator? Are you on a quest to raise your vibration and your consciousness? I'm Sam Liebowitz, your conscious consultant, and on my show, The Conscious Consultant Hour, Awakening Humanity, we will touch upon all these topics and more. Listen live at our new time on Thursdays at 12 noon Eastern Time. That's The Conscious Consultant Hour, Awakening Humanity, Thursdays, 12 noon on talkradio.nyc.
Are you interested in having a better relationship with yourself, others, and God? Greetings. I'm your host, Dr. George Andow, for the show, A Journey Through Into Awareness. On my show, we journey into the awareness that the mind of God is the true seat of our personal consciousness. We join together each Monday at 7 p.m., so tune in on Talk Radio NYC.
Listening to Talk Radio NYC. Uplift, educate, empower.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, everybody. This is Frank here, being frank about caregiving with Dr. Phyllis, who's joined me this week to really look at frank about health, but from a nurse's view. And I'm looking forward to hear a lot of what she's thought of the catalog of shows that a lot of people have been able to both hear on talkradio.nyc, as well as now currently on Facebook Live for the past 8 weeks. So Phyllis, I do want to first mention you do have a book out there, which is called Bringing Shadow Behavior into the Light of Day. I had to look on Amazon.com because there was no way I was going to remember that title.
But no, that's okay.
What I find intriguing is that you're going to bring to the light of my day what kind of messages I have been able to provide our listeners out there and how it has been received by someone like yourself who is a professional in the healthcare space. So I'm looking forward to hear about your book, as well as what about Frank About Health really inspired you.
So I'll start with the book, Frank. The book is really a short read. It's meant to be more of a workbook than an academic study on the issue of disruptive behavior in healthcare. It's really meant to really break down disruptive behavior into two manageable categories. One, someone who's chronically uncivil. You know, someone who comes to the workplace and can't get to work on time, can't get their job done. You know, they suck all the energy out of the break room by talking about the latest drama in their lives. You know, it's that soul who, if they call in sick, you feel like you're going to have a better day. You know, that even if you're working short, the workplace is going to be easier to be in because that kind of disruptive energy is not going to be present. They really have low emotional intelligence. They're not, they don't intentionally look to harm someone. There's no real agenda. They just have low emotional intelligence and really are sometimes unaware or just unable to reflect on how they come across in groups and how they negatively affect the workplace.
That is narcissistic behavior, correct?
That's right. And, you know, I'm not sure if I want to say fortunately or unfortunately, but of the issue of disruptive behavior, the person who is chronically uncivil is the largest proportion of disruptive behavior in the workplace. And, you know, you can work with these souls. It takes a tremendous amount of time, effort, resources. And if you want to put in the time, effort, and resources, you can coach them, you can train them, you can hopefully, you know, develop their emotional intelligence so that they can have that much more self-awareness and be able to self-manage better, and then have more of an adult approach to life, if you will, and then couple that with their clinical skills and you have a more solid individual in that workplace. Mm-hmm. I mean, that can be done, but not everybody has the time, the resources, and the money to be able to do that. Mm-hmm. The other disruptive behavior, which only makes up about 3-5% of the disruptive behavior category, is the actual bully. And I think what really struck me about Frank About Health is that you offered 3 episodes about narcissism. And in my opinion, and what I put forth in the book, is that in order to understand a true bully, someone who is abusive, someone who, for whatever reason, has an agenda to try to take the confidence, the enthusiasm, the life force, if you will, out of another human being, mm-hmm. to assert their primary need for self over the greater good of the team, that person is a narcissist. Mm-hmm. And we, as I shared with you earlier, we are not really trained and schooled enough in as much of the behavioral, you know, issues, behavioral health issues as we need to.
Right.
So, you know, bringing forth an understanding how a narcissist, how that personality disorder thinks and how they work, which is really what the book is about, it's important because narcissists confuse, confound, they use gaslighting communication techniques, they rely a lot on plausible deniability. And if you're not careful about navigating dealing with that individual, if you're not going to join forces with executive leadership and human resources, you can find yourself on the opposite end of the problem.
Right.
Meaning that person will flip things, confuse things such that you're the person that's really abusive to them. And then you could find yourself in a career-ending moment if you are not careful.
Correct.
So my mission right now is to try to help leaders raise awareness about how to effectively deal with the bullying narcissist. Right. So that first, you are safe in your quest to create a healthier work environment. And then second, you do what you need to do to, you know, effectively deal with that individual.
So would you say it's obviously you'll be focused primarily on the healthcare sector because that's where you do your daily work.
Right.
But would you qualify other professional sectors that have this case of the bully and the narcissist at work?
So the feedback that I am getting when I have spoken on podcasts or I have given lectures that, you know, the information I have is really relevant for just about every workplace. Mm-hmm. And that unfortunately, disruptive behavior is something that is common to just about every workplace. Now, how well the leadership navigates that, how well they put forth a culture of a healthy work environment, how well do they, you know, stay visible to their workforce that they can understand, you know, something's going on here, how much they want to acknowledge the elephant in the room, so to speak, that nobody wants to talk about, but everybody knows is there. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like we sweep around and, well, maybe we'll fix this and we'll try this. But this is the issue here. The disruptive behavior is the issue. And what I want to do is really the book is intended to give leaders just a little bit more confidence about how then to approach executive leadership and human resources in a coordinated effort to have a program to work with this person.
So are you saying that from your experience that you find it is up to the human resources department to really advocate for that quality of individual, not the one that is the bully, but to make the working conditions such that it would detract from it, those kinds of employees becoming part of the organization?
Right. So what I am saying is that leadership has to make their case. You can't just go up and say, I don't want this person working with us, they're a bully. You know, you have to have evidence. You cannot just malign somebody's reputation. You cannot say, I want them exited from the organization. You have to do your due diligence and document, you know, how you've been working with this person and how that person's responded to your efforts. Mm-hmm. But you have to do it in such a way that executive leadership and human resources knows what you're doing. Mm-hmm. So that there is a coordinated effort and a one message being offered. You know, so that there are opportunities for remediation to be offered, opportunities to advance your emotional intelligence, opportunities for perhaps anger management, opportunities for how to have a better conversation, you know, have more awareness about the things that trigger you. Mm-hmm. Those kinds of opportunities that you're working with this individual. And, you know, this individual then as a professional, you know, has an obligation either to latch on to what's being offered and improve, or make a decision that whatever's being offered is not really for them. It's their attitude usually is everyone else needs to change. I'm just fine. You know, a typical narcissistic mindset.
Right.
And then at that point, there has to be a decision between human resources and executive leadership as to what the next step might be.
So how would you say that the person that lacks emotional intelligence and is in the healthcare field, where empathy is sorely needed, especially for the patients,
right,
how is it that they even get through the front door with already the limited lack of emotional intelligence? I mean, isn't that easily screened in the beginning?
No, we don't do that kind of screening, not that I'm aware of. Okay, we may be doing it now. The more we're moving away from transactional approaches to healthcare to more transformational approaches to healthcare. There are longer onboarding periods. There are internships, fellowships. There is more of an engagement before you marry kind of period.
Yes.
You know, where you get to know the person a little bit better. And we have finally, with transformational leadership principles, started to weave in the importance of interpersonal skills, not just academic knowledge and clinical skills.
Right.
That really we understand, you know, when I started, it was academic knowledge, clinical skills, certifications, and you would have a great career. We know now the secret sauce is emotional intelligence. And we are finally starting to weave that in so that you have someone who's knowledgeable in their profession, highly skilled at what they do, has really good understanding of themselves first and able to relate authentically to others. And that equates then to success.
Would you say that when our former governor Andrew Cuomo labeled the essential worker, the nurses and the EMT staff and all those people, to really have a role in trying to maintain or control this pandemic, that was the birth of this missing element that most people were not trained with, the ability to really be more mindful of the individual that you were dealing with?
No, I think what the pandemic really showed to the world is, you know, the courage of the professional caregiver. The fact that, you know, there are jobs and there is then a mission and, you know, a purpose. And you don't get up in the morning, put on your scrubs, then put on your PPE and get deployed to an area you've never worked before to take care of people who are highly infectious. If you don't have a strong sense of mission and purpose, and you know that you are among the universe's most generous people, and that, you know, you're part of the legion of light workers in the universe, you just can't do that.
Right.
So I think the pandemic showcased that, you know, maybe healthcare was being taken for granted. You know, I can tell you some of the unsung heroes of the pandemic, you know, were taken for granted. EVS, the lab, you know, transportation, EMS, you know, people we don't necessarily do TV programs about and showcase, but, you know, where would we be without our environmental service workers? Where would we be without our nursing assistants? Dietary, you know, infection prevention folks, you know, always were the academics who were, you know, making sure you were washing your hands. And now they were our lifeline to surviving, to helping us really navigate something that was highly infectious, but also giving us the knowledge and the tools and the skills to be able to do what we needed to do based in science,
right.
You know, and really then showcase our, you know, how much this profession shines. So I think the pandemic did that.
I guess it's appropriate. Do you have a picture of your book that people
do?
Yeah, because the title is describing exactly what you just mentioned about the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
The people lurking in the shadows were the essential workers, and it was the pandemic itself that shined the light into their value.
I think that's a great analogy. You know, in healthcare, we often refer to an interprofessional team.
Right.
And, you know, we talk about it, we kind of emphasize maybe we should work as an interprofessional or intercollaborative team.
Well, we're about to take another break, but that actually is the perfect segue for the team that you are involved with, Share the Care, which we want to talk more about in the next section. But I do want to hear more about what you were about to say when we come back. So, ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned for this episode as we're being frank about caregiving right here on talkradio.nyc and on Facebook Live. And if you have any comments, please email me at frankabouthealth102@gmail.com. Stay tuned.
I am Joseph Franklin McElroy, host of the new podcast, Gateway to the Smokies. It airs on talkradio.nyc every Tuesday night from 6 p.m. to 7. Every episode is dedicated to memorable experiences in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park and surrounding areas. This show features experts and locals who expound upon the richness of culture, history, and adventure that awaits you in the Smokies. Tune in every Tuesday from 6 p.m. to 7 on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a cannabis enthusiast, a cannabis professional, or interested in entering the cannabis space? I'm Johnny Tsunami, and this is Planet Baco Lolo, a less taboo view. On our show, we will discuss the cannabis world through the perspective of various cannabis professionals. Tune in every Thursday evening, Eastern Standard Time, 6 p.m., Talk Radio NYC, Planet Baco Lolo, a less taboo view.
Are you passionate about the conversation around racism? Hi, I'm Reverend Dr. TLC, host of the Dismantle Racism Show, which airs every Thursday at 11 a.m. Eastern on talkradio.nyc. Join me and my amazing guests as we discuss ways to uncover, dismantle, and eradicate racism. That's Thursdays at 11 o'clock a.m. on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a small business trying to navigate the COVID-19 related employment laws? Hello, I'm Eric Sauver, employment law business law attorney and host of the new radio show, Employment Law Today. On my show, we'll have guests to discuss the common employment law challenges business owners are facing during these trying times. Tune in on Tuesday evenings from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Time on talkradio.nyc.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC at www.talkradio.nyc. Now broadcasting 24 hours a day.
Hey, everybody, and welcome back to this episode of Frank About Health. I'm here with Dr. Phyllis. She was just closing the last segment discussing about the importance of work teams. If you don't mind, I'm sorry I interrupted you for the break, but I wanted you to finish what you were saying because it was right going into what we're going to talk about now.
You know, so as we move closer to really developing emotional intelligence and appreciation for each other in the healthcare field, again, you know, there was a lot of silver linings to the pandemic. And one of them was taking the concept of we should all work as a team and actually making it happen so that, you know, we really had much more complete and full understandings of each other's role. We certainly could sit back and in awe of wonder of each other's strengths and courage and dedication. And I think coming out of that now, we probably are closest to really fully appreciating the importance of working together as an interprofessional team.
Correct. I mean, would you also say that a lot of us are also going to have our own version of PTSD from being quarantined and socially distanced and not? There are some that unfortunately, especially with low emotional IQ, are not going to fully grasp what just happened and appreciate the fact that there was opportunity in it if they were able to be enlightened by it.
Yeah, I think that there's a potential. If people had some behavioral challenges or behavioral health challenges prior, I think that's possible. Mm-hmm. I think that most of us, you know, I'm hoping that they will, you know, reach out to individuals, whether it is a good friend, a colleague, a coach, someone to help them navigate their feelings, untie that knot, that COVID experience knot, if you will, right. So that there is a higher potential for post-traumatic growth than there is for post-traumatic stress. And that's really what coaching can offer.
You just showed a light on the idea of PTSD. Some aspect of recovery is growing from the experience. And I guess
that's right.
What most people unfortunately don't do, especially depending on the severity of their PTSD, is they really don't become aware of what it was right. That they were supposed to learn right. From the experience.
I'm not trying to minimize that, you know, PTSD exists. Of course it does, right. You know, and there are wonderful therapists and physicians out there that help individuals do that. But, you know, for a larger segment of the population, working with a coach or a confidant or a strong family member, someone that they can, you know, just really be heard by, can really help transform that post-traumatic stress into post-traumatic growth.
Correct. Well, similarly speaking, in my own situation with the pandemic, I mean, it's been known, especially by the people at Talk Radio NYC, that I'm an epileptic. I've been living with it since I was a teenager. And that was the impetus for Frank About Health. But what made me come back and relaunch Frank About Health was my own awareness that I had while living with my ill father, who was recovering from prostate cancer, and also trying to prevent him and my mother, because we were living in the same vicinity, the same apartment. And when I got COVID, I isolated myself beyond belief. They thought I was offending them. I was protecting them. And lo and behold, even though I did my best, my father did get it, but asymptomatically. So I guess I did
my best effort.
And simultaneously, when he got the vaccine, what I noticed is that his overall healthcare improved, period. Mm-hmm. And that in itself is still left for future understanding and research. But the whole thing that brought to my attention was I need to come back and be a patient advocate, yes. You know, not just about epilepsy, but also about COVID, about cancer, about cardiac care, about all of the aspects that I have continued to be exposed to, even within my own family. So I feel like that this show, as well as what we're talking about today, is all about self-awareness and understanding that a lot of people, if they really can grasp what their benefits are from being through a pandemic, they can really make their own agenda, their own mission, further advance what the previous mission was, if possible. And yeah. I can see it definitely involves a lot of emotional intelligence, even if it needs to be taught. I gather that's one of the new curriculums that'll probably be developed in med schools or nursing schools or things like that going forward, you think?
I would hope. I'm not really sure we're there yet, but I think some version of it is there. We're certainly offering it more and more as continuing education, certainly trying to weave it in all aspects of onboarding someone, whether it's the didactic class that they need to learn or even in the skilled competency-based things that we are not just looking at, do you know what you're doing and do you have the skills to do it? But are you making that, are you aware enough of yourself so that you can be authentic and make that genuine human connection with another?
Yes, exactly. Which brings me right to sharethecare.org. The thing is I gather this is what you have experienced in your education, in your training, in your development, in your own entrepreneurial nature. Tell me how you became part of Share the Care and what that organization is providing to healthcare workers, to anyone such as myself who wants to be an advocate.
Right. Well, Share the Care is .org or Share the Care Giving was founded by Sheila Warnick. And it is New York City based, and it comes out of her experiences of trying to navigate the healthcare system as the only child present in the continental United States to take care of her aging mom. Mm-hmm. And just really learning about the differences of acute care versus long-term care versus assisted living, and realizing that it was, you know, it takes a little bit of a village to actually take care of someone safely so that you don't burn out in the meantime. Right. She learned a lot through her own experience, and then she went on to actually be part of a team that took care of one of her friends and colleagues who developed cancer. And they created this care group around this individual. The individual who was ill kind of said, to her, you know, next time you come for your counseling, I want you to bring 10 or 12 of your friends. And through that, Share the Caregiving was born. So what Sheila has written about and what she shares is that, you know, many people want to do something, they just don't know what they can do. Not everybody is able to do physical hands-on caregiving, but other people can set up a computer, can do online shopping, can help maybe transport somebody to a doctor's visit or a treatment center. Mm-hmm. You know, and people are more than willing to help if you just show them, you know, that, well, if you're strong in this, you can certainly help us out there. And she's put together this entire program that she is sharing with everybody who will stand still for 10 minutes and try to learn. So this is something that she has shared internationally. And with a lot of different cultures and a lot of indigenous groups and cultures that are far more family centric, mm-hmm. and certainly do put caring groups around individuals. She's worked with church groups and things of that nature, but it is a not-for-profit organization. And I personally feel it is the missing ingredient in our acute care system right now, because I know that we are trying to discharge people to home. And we want to, you know, do some care navigation around that. You will always want to discharge someone safely. Mm-hmm. The two big reasons why people come back into the hospital within 30 or 45 days of discharge has to do with they didn't understand their discharge instructions, mostly around medications, or you have caregiver burnout. Mm-hmm. So I think that acute care hospitals, quite honestly, should take a really good look at Share the Care. And they should think about weaving this into their discharge planning. I think that having communities come together around someone who needs caring for and just helping them set up the thinking process, mm-hmm. of, gee, I'm available on Monday afternoons or I'm available on Thursday mornings, and putting together a calendar that everybody can help the person needing care for, being cared for, but also the primary caregiver. This doesn't absolve the primary caregiver of any responsibilities, but it certainly lightens the load and gives them it no longer makes them feel isolated. They are part of a community, their care group, and then of course the larger community. And when you go to get discharge instructions or you go to hear about what's the next step in perhaps your cancer treatment, sometimes your emotions interfere with what you need to actually hear and the questions you need to actually ask. And this care group can, with of course HIPAA identification and all the protection and privacy things addressed,
right,
this care group can then almost act like a think tank for this person. And the more knowledge you have in the group, the less likely you have for readmission, the more comfortable people are staying at home where they want to be, but they're also supporting the caregiver and they are keeping that person at home more safely and, you know, with a lot more sense of confidence and socialization around them.
So share the care is more for the caregiver or it's for the healthcare professional or both?
Well, I would say that it is, it used to be 50-50 for the person being cared for and the person doing the primary caregiving. Okay. But I think now there is a lot of room to let share the care be of service to the acute care and long-term care venues, even home care venues. Because again, if the acute care facilities start to learn more about the methodology of share the care, they can weave this more into their discharge planning and have a far more robust offering to give someone who is petrified that they're taking their loved one home and not sure they can handle it.
So then basically someone like myself, who's right now caretaking for my cousin, who is she's about my age group. So it's not like senior situation, but she has her son who's her CDPAP worker. She has a friend of hers who takes her to her doctor visits. She has me to help me, her proxy at NYU Langone, but then she really needs other support workers, her PCP. That's the group you're referring to that could become part of this Share the Care organization.
And even more, someone might just, say, well, I don't know how to do anything other than maybe just be a companion and go in and visit. Well, that's wonderful, because then somebody, while you go in and be a companion and visit with the person who is in need of care, perhaps the caregiver can go to the dentist and take care of themselves where they would put off their own care,
right, because
they can't figure out how they're going to navigate all the responsibilities and still do the self-care needed to keep them in the game. So, each caregiver group kind of evolves organically around the unique situations of the person being cared for and the unique situations of that primary caregiver. But it has been very successful internationally. And I think if we start to widen our thinking and start to bring in people who can then train discharge planners, social workers, care navigators, all of this, they can start to understand the concepts. And it's a conversation you can start to have with the family when you first start discharge planning, which essentially is on admission.
We are about to take another break, but I want you to finish even more. I'm enthralled at this conversation. I have to let you know. Ladies and gentlemen, please stay tuned. We're being frank about caregiving right here on Frank About Health with Dr. Phyllis and myself, Frank R. Harrison, on talkradio.nyc and Facebook Live. Stay tuned.
Hey, everybody, it's Tommy D, the nonprofit sector connector, coming at you from my attic. Each week here on talkradio.nyc, I host a program, Philanthropy in Focus. Nonprofits impact us each and every day, and it's my focus to help them amplify their message and tell their story. Listen each week at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time until 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on talkradio.nyc.
Do you feel uninformed about menopause and how it impacts on your life? Hi, I'm Pat Duckworth, women's health strategist and host of the Hot Women Rock radio show, Empowering Women Leaders at Menopause. Join me every Thursday at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, 3 p.m. UK time on talkradio.nyc for interviews with inspirational women who will share their top tips to rock your world.
Have you ever thought of reinventing yourself? Are you looking to create a new life's journey? Hi, I'm Kevin Barbaro, host of Coffee Talk XL every Tuesday night, 5, 8 p.m. Eastern on talkradio.nyc. Tune in live to hear me and my guests from a variety of different backgrounds. As a former college coach and a current full-time actor and owner of multiple companies, my show is as eclectic as my life. That's Coffee Talk XL, every Tuesday night, 8 p.m. on talkradio.nyc.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC at www.talkradio.nyc. Now broadcasting 24 hours a day.
Hey, everybody, welcome back to our final segment of this episode of Frank About Health. For the last 45 minutes, I've been frank about caregiving with Dr. Phyllis, who's joined the show to really talk about the books that she's written, the experience she's had, the understanding of how Frank About Health has been an advocate for people, especially those that have unfortunately been exposed to narcissistic behavior. There's also been the understanding that her participation in the Share the Care organization is providing insight into the ways that all of us can go out there, especially if you're a caregiver, a healthcare provider, or even you yourself are receiving care. You can form a network of people to really provide you adequate care to prevent unfortunate revisits to the doctor or probably spending more money than you need to on medicines. Of course, as the eventual going to a nursing home if it can be avoided. Now, what I really learned from you, Dr. Phyllis, is that you definitely have a multi-dynamic experience in the healthcare space. Besides your education and training, you have the behavioral understanding. And you also have a very sharp business mind. I like the sound of it from the perspective of how people can go ahead and look for the resources, even when they are unaware of them themselves. You have been able to shine a light on where they can find their resources. What would you say, though, is the future, though, in the nursing profession and the healthcare profession and in the various aspects of things you've touched upon? There's definitely a new future in this whole ecosystem that we have a century of experience with, but realize there was always this missing element that only now is coming to awareness. What would you say is the future?
So that is a huge question, Frank.
I know.
Okay, I'm going to try to sum it up a little bit. I think the future is a combination of, you know, starting in the preventative world first. I think the future is going to be a lot more about the importance of body, mind, and spirit, the importance of, you know, teaching children from the get-go how to take care of their health, how to eat correctly, even, you know, perhaps how to do mindfulness as opposed to, you know, having detention. Maybe, you know, they'll learn how to do self-management and understand their triggers, having a connection to purpose. I'm very, very excited about this Gen Z population or the Gen Z that are coming up, because right. It's almost like for an old hippie like myself, I've been waiting for this generation my whole life. They are so diverse. They are so accepting. They are unafraid of change. They very much see themselves as citizens of this planet and not just citizens of any one specific group.
Right.
They are very, very involved in social justice issues. You can see how involved they are with climate change, gun control, just to name two. Right, so I think that the future is literally coming out of school, coming out of college. Okay. Now, for those of us who have been practicing longer, the challenge for the future is to make them feel welcome.
Not only that, but to also put into the schools what we did not have.
Seriously, but make them feel welcome right there, because they're coming out of college and going, you know, perhaps coming out of nursing school, but going into medical school or dental school or what have you. But we have to create an organization that signals that we are part of the planet and not just in it for ourselves. You know, this has been, you know, healthcare has been somewhat of an institution. And I think now we have to have a far more global perspective as to what we are doing. We have to talk about issues of access, availability. We have to see where telehealth is going to take us. We have to talk about diversity. I live in Queens, New York, the most diverse place on the planet. We have to talk about onboarding, making sure that we have translators readily available 24/7. We have to be that much more empathetic with people's choices for gender identification and you know, who they choose to love and what constitutes a family. Mm-hmm. And even what constitutes, you know, being having a professional look, because tattoos are here to stay. Purple hair is here to stay. Piercing is here to stay. You know, and I can tell you that would never fly in 1,000 days when I started. But now, you know, we have to look at things differently. But the most important thing I think we need to do is create a welcoming, well, efficiently run, healthy work environment that has real collaboration, real communication, mm-hmm. certainly shared governance, authentic participation by the people who are using the end product of the services. Mm-hmm. People are now, we have the most intelligent workforce coming out of school right now. Mm. It's never going to be top down again, nor should it.
No.
We need to learn how to listen to one another. First, listen to one another. Mm-hmm. And we have to be able to lean into our own unconscious biases that are somewhat, you know, maybe even taking that unconscious bias wall down one brick at a time.
Right.
And that can feel like chewing on glass. So I'm asking for something that can be a little challenging, myself included. And, you know, understanding how we have to create something that is truly diverse, inclusive, accessible. Mm-hmm. And as far as the future of nursing, I think that we are going to grow some great leaders. About 4 to 5% of nursing, today's nurses are prepared at the doctorate level. We now have the ability to have advanced practitioners. And if the nurse practitioner role and even the physician assistant role was not fully appreciated before the pandemic, well, it is appreciated now because we never would have been able to do this without them. And there's no putting that genie back in the bottle. We all have to figure out how we're going to navigate and get along because they truly stood up and delivered.
Right.
So I think there is, I'm very excited about the future. You know, I'm not Pollyanna. I'm not trying to say it's not going to be without its issues and it's not going to be without its bumps. But I am excited that we are in a place where we are holding each other's hands and holding our breath as we try to get through the stuff that's been holding us back.
Right.
But I think we have some fine.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, but also being aware that it is unfortunate that even though we are coming from a level playing field, we are still living in a society that is still 50-50 divided based on.
Yeah, I'm just going to respectfully disagree. I don't think we're in a living playing field at all. You know, that's been for a while. I mean, my most of my career has been spent in the emergency department when, you know, as a clinician. So, you know, you see how unlevel the playing field is.
Right.
You see the challenges, you know, it may be one of the new competencies going into healthcare across this country just may be a requirement to be bilingual. You know, that I never learned a second language. I have 27 words of high school French, you know, but it just may be that, you know, if you're going to practice in a diverse area, you know, well, maybe one of those practice skills might be the ability to make that authentic connection, not so much on a translator phone, but face to face. So I throw that out as a possibility. You know, I'm not sure what will happen, but it's certainly worthy of leaning into and seeing if, you know, that might be something we need to weave into, you know, the medical care or the nursing care preparation. Mm-hmm. Make it a prerequisite that at least you have so many credits in something coming out of high school so that you can lean into that going into college.
Right.
We're going to get comfortable with online training. We're going to get comfortable with online and telecommunication to increase accessibility. Mm-hmm. You know, healthcare is going to rely on, you know, having a lot of internet access. It's not just going to be about physicians. It's going to be about the leaders of our healthcare across the country,
working with
government to make sure that, you know, great if we have telehealth, but if we don't have internet access towers, where internet access towers need to be, so much for telehealth.
Right.
So again, I think the interprofessional team in healthcare is going to start to incrementally expand beyond those of us who practice, to those of us who lead, to those of us who educate, and to those of us who choose to be community leaders as well.
Right. Well, we're about to end the show, but basically, in short, everything that you've just said is what I think people like you and myself are trying to do using media as a platform. You've written some successful books out there that are going to be used as guides. We actually have some pop culture references. Grey's Anatomy is an 18-year-old series that is showing all of the ways of medical professionals dealing with each other, both from a primitive point of view and even those that are being more compassionate in their training. I think for those people who love the show, it's a good model. But I think at the same time, it really involves ourselves and taking action, as you and I both have started to do in various ways. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for attending this episode of Frank About Health. I have decided at this moment to re-air this show next week. It is important for those who didn't have a chance to listen to get a hold of it, because I'm going to work with Dr. Phyllis in the future on this show. And at the same time, you have to be concerned about all of us as a community, the listeners, the viewers, and the hosts of Talk Radio NYC are all trying to collaborate together, as we've discussed with Share the Care. And stay tuned for Johnny Tsunami on Planet Pacalolo, where he's going to talk about his weekly episode of cannabis. But one of the episodes I recently heard was about medical cannabis. So again, we are all collaborating together on this network. And all of you who are listening to us each week, I thank you for your viewership. Please forward to myself or Dr. Phyllis any questions at frankabouthealth102@gmail.com. Stay tuned for Planet Pacalolo. Stay tuned for this episode next week. And ladies and gentlemen, we're signing off. Thank you, Dr. Phyllis, for being here today. And I will be
in touch
for the weekend.
All right. Bye-bye now.
Take care.